my witness list is not comprehensive, but I will be submitting to the Toronto hearings statements from 156 eyewitnesses. So this will be an appendix to my presentation. It's 35 pages long because it includes the actual words of each of these people. I've created a couple of graphs. So this refers to my 156, which certainly, as I say, isn't comprehensive. Most of them are members of the Fire Department of New York because of that extremely rich source, the World Trade Task Force interviews, World Trade Center Task Force interviews. Secondly, Port Authority Police Department, then reporters, and then other, mainly civilians in the location, in that location. And I just want to point out a couple of things quickly about this. First is that about 87% of the witnesses I'm dealing with were first responders, either firefighters or police officers, who had far more experience with explosions than most of us. And I think the evidence, the documents, are high quality. This is high quality eyewitness evidence. And I can explain a little bit what I mean by that later. The other thing is the reporters. Many of these are video clips, and it took me a while to realize what good evidence this is. This is unmediated. Nobody's transcribing or interpreting or interrupting or anything. There they are, on the scene. Most of this is from 9/11, and some of it is within seconds of the events. And that's very important because, of course, the story changes over time. Second graph has to do with the terms used by the witnesses. And here I have to pause to explain my method a little bit. Again, being troubled by people who claim that there's a vague boom somewhere and immediately I put them in the list as an explosion witness, I have to explain, if all they said that there was a boom, if all they said was that there was a boom, they're not in the list. They're not one of the 156. I try not to interpret. I get the eyewitness to interpret. They don't get in the list, with one minor exception, the category of other. Other is where I see something that looks like a controlled demolition description, so I put it in. But in all the other cases, they're there because the eyewitness themselves have used a particular term. Explosion, or the verb to explode, blast, bomb, blow up, implosion. So in other words, if they don't use the term in the description, they're not in the list. So it's a pretty good list, this 156. And I guess I would just want to point out the obvious, that explosion and explode are far more common than any of the others, but the term bomb, and this also includes related terms like secondary device, is also common. It's in 32 cases, and most of them are firefighters. They wouldn't use the term unless they felt this was an explosion that you don't expect to encounter in a building fire. So it's an important category.
Graeme,
yes, Richard.
Quick question on that. Would some individuals be using two or even three or more of these terms?
Yes, it's an important question. The 156 refers to the number of individual people. The number of references to explosion and so on is much higher. So a given witness might use the term explosion three or four times, or they might use explosion and bomb, or they might, you know, any number of combinations. This is the number of people who use one of these terms at least once. Now, how am I doing for time, Michael? Okay, so I've got about 5 minutes? 10 minutes, okay, thank you. There is a third objection that's often raised to our talk about explosions in the towers. And I don't think I'm going to have time to deal with it very well in my talk. If you wish, the panel or the audience may want to return to it later. But the objection is this. Of course there were explosions. You encounter all kinds of explosions in office fires, especially in large office fires like this. So the fact that people perceived explosions doesn't mean that they were from explosives or that they were deliberately planted. Now that, of the three major common objections, that is, I think, the most serious one. And I don't want to be seen as rushing over it. But I'll just say briefly now that although I'm certainly not an explosion expert, I have studied the manuals, and as far as I have been able to determine, there are only four major kinds of explosions that we would have expected to encounter that would be major, fairly major explosions in a natural fire. If others want to add other ones, let them do so. But the four that I have found are, first of all, a blevy, which stands for boiling liquid expanding vapor explosion, as when a boiler blows up, electrical explosion, smoke explosion or backdraft, and finally combustion explosion, natural gas or jet fuel vapor. I believe that none of these, either singly or in combination, accounts for the eyewitness evidence that we have, not to mention the other evidence, which you'll be hearing later today. And I can say a little bit more, if you like, about that after in the Q&A. But for now, I need to go to my third point, which is that this eyewitness evidence has been ignored or suppressed by the 9/11 Commission and the National Institute of Standards and Technology. And I can be fairly brief here, because if we ask how many references there are to eyewitnesses evident to eyewitness statements about explosions in the towers in the 585 pages of the 9/11 Commission, we find that there is one sentence fragment. They are discussing firefighters who were in the North Tower when the South Tower came down, and this is what they say. Those firefighters now standing near windows facing south had no way of knowing that the South Tower had collapsed. Many surmised that a bomb had exploded. That's it. 585 pages. This implies that eyewitnesses who thought there were explosions were in the North Tower at the time the South Tower came down. In fact, most of them weren't. It also implies that they made a mistake. And they made that mistake because they had an impeded view. They weren't near a window. They couldn't see what was going on. This is grotesquely misleading. Many eyewitnesses were looking directly at the towers. And I've already showed you examples. So whether it's deliberate or not, this is an extremely inadequate and misleading way of dealing with this important testimony. If we ask about the National Institute of Standards and Technology now, which was given the specific job of figuring out why these buildings collapsed, how many references are there to eyewitnesses to explosions in the towers in the 295 pages of the final report? Zero. Not one. Now, some people think, oh, well, but that's natural because NIST only deals with hard stuff, you know, like column size and whatnot. They're not concerned with soft stuff like eyewitness evidence. False. NIST was proud of the interviews it conducted. It had a sophisticated methodology. It planned it from early on, and you can find it described in Chapter 7. Phone interviews, one-on-one interviews, face-to-face, focus groups. But they appear not to have directed them to this question, so that they give detailed information about what was happening at various times in the building, but we hear nothing about this. Now, you need to know that the 9/11 Commission and NIST had access to the same material that I have access to. It's not as if I have some mysterious sources here. And yet they both miss my 156 eyewitnesses to explosions. Not to mention many other eyewitnesses that are not in my list. Whether that's deliberate suppression of evidence, which would be a crime, or whether it's simply massive incompetence, does not concern me today, because either way, we have an investigation that is thoroughly inadequate, and that's why we need a new one. And I want to end with one last guy, Gary Gates. I looked up and the building exploded. The whole top came off like a volcano. And, you know, Gary Gates could, of course, be wrong, but if you ask me if 156 are wrong, I'm going to say no, I don't think so. Thank you.